Foo Fighters were, I mean, they're a great band, and they are such a good band, guys. My Hero, the best, Run. I mean, the Everlong was a masterpiece. That song is a masterpiece, legit, a legitimate masterpiece. Everlong. And for those of you guys who have never heard the song Everlong, you YouTube that shit. Look up the song Everlong by Foo Fighters. That's a magical piece of music right there. And it was made in the 90s. It's so beautiful. I can't even mimic it. Just listen to it. Everything about that song, the verses, the lyrics, the transitions between verse and chorus, everything about it. And then there's that, like, there's that weird solo piece where he's whispering things in the microphone. It's just, it's a magical piece of music. Guys, I first heard that song when I was in high school. I was a junior in high school. I first heard that piece of music. And I thought, what is this? Sounds beautiful. I've been listening to it ever since. So I was listening to Everlong every single day. Pretty much every single day. That song was it's part of the soundtrack of my life. It's obviously part of the soundtracks of a lot of people's lives. And there was this one girl I remember, I think her name was Amanda. And Amanda sat right across from me in English class. Amanda was white girl, long hair, brunette, looked like that pretty, but you knew that she was going to get, you knew she was going to bloat. She was going to blimp up after pregnancy, right? But she was a good looking girl. But she was like a free spirit, you know? And she was one of those girls who didn't mind talking about gross bodily things. Like, oh, I got sweat under, you know, it's stuff that men say, but women aren't expected to say, which was kind of gross. I'll be honest with you. It's kind of gross when a woman starts talking about that kind of stuff. I think that's kind of nasty, but I kind of, you know, I was attracted to this woman, and I used to listen to Everlong on my little MP3, and I sat across from her, which meant I had to look at her. Or I was, you know, facing her for over an hour. You know, I wasn't always looking at her, but, you know, she was in front of you. And that music would be playing in my head. And I always thought, like, there's this part of the song in Everlong where he says, if everything could be this way forever. And I always thought, man, if I could start a relationship with Amanda, with this woman, like that, like this song would mean so much, right? Because I was listening to the song, and then I saw her, and, you know, like, really liked her, and I saw her every single day. And I always thought, like, if I had a relationship with this woman, I'd be so, at that age, I thought, like, if I can get a relationship with this woman, I'd be super happy, right? I would be, like, so fulfilled in life, and it would be like, you know, finding the pot of gold at the end of the rainbow. But nothing happened. I never approached her because I didn't have the guts to do it. And I always thought to myself, if I ask her out, she'll just reject me. That's what I always thought. So I never talked to her. I never approached her. Never did anything like that. And then in 2015, you know, graduated high school, did the whole thing. And then in 2015, on my birthday, when I turned 25, I went to the theater on my 25th birthday. I never forget it because I watched a movie called Sicario. And if you have not seen the film Sicario, I highly recommend it. A great movie. They made a sequel for the film, which was better than the first one. That's my opinion. I think the second Sicario film was an amazing movie, and I think better than the first one. But the first one is still a good movie nonetheless. The movie Sicario is, I mean, the title is self-explanatory. It's about Mexican gangs fighting the authorities, and it's a great movie. And I remember watching that film in theater, and I thought, wow, what a cool movie, you know. And at that time, I was making a documentary about the violence going on in Mexico, and I was interviewing all these different Mexican people who dealt with the cartels. And it was a very interesting time in my life, because I was doing a documentary, and I really, really put my heart and soul into this documentary. I was interviewing all these different people. I had to do translation work, subtitle work. I was just doing so much. A lot of research, spent hours in conversation with different people, and it was a lot of work. I mean, it took almost a year to do it. You know, it was a lot of work, but I took some time to watch this movie for my 25th birthday. And after watching the film, I decided to, nearby the theater was this fish and chips restaurant. It was an English pub restaurant. So I decided that because I was really hungry, you know, you're stuck in the theater for, you know, 2 hours or whatever, you're hungry. So I decided to spoil myself with some fish and chips for my 25th birthday. So I walked to this restaurant and went in there, had a bunch of soda pop, and I not drank any beer, but I ate a lot of fish and chips. All right. By the time I got out of that restaurant, it was like 9:30 p.m. And I saw Amanda in front of the restaurant. It was crazy. But I saw her there and I was like, oh wow. Like, maybe this is a sign from God, you know, we're being reunited. And next to her, she was sitting in the table, you know, because the restaurant had an outdoor and indoor section. And she was sitting at a table in front of the restaurant with this like ginormous white guy who was way taller than me and way more muscular than me, way more robust than me. I guess we could just say he was a Chad, right? And I saw this guy and I and I saw that and I kind of bumped into her accidentally and she was like, oh, excuse me. I was like, oh, don't worry about it. And I saw this guy and I was like, that, and I, in my brain, I'm like, Ted, you were 100% right not to approach this girl. There's no way she would have said yes to you. So that was it, guys. That was it. Yeah, they're making a third Sicario. Yep. High school love is literally more powerful than drugs. Like that high school infatuation that you have for a woman, there's nothing like it, guys. There's nothing like it. And once you hit a certain age, I think once you hit your 30s, whatever love potion that was running through your blood is dried up and gone. Because at that point, by the time you hit your 30s, you're like, a lot of you ladies are blimping out and looking like you're about to be arrested by the police, or you're about to be filmed for an episode of Cops, and all on. Like, a lot of the ladies that you knew in high school, they look like that they are about to be in an episode of Mari. So all that shit gets thrown out the window and you're totally disillusioned, and all that like factuation that you had, it dissipated like a cloud in the winter time, okay? Or in the summertime. Bumped into, no, seriously, I forgot. I was just walking. I think I like bumped it. I forgot what happened, man. But she was like, oh, excuse me. I'm like, don't worry about it. And I looked at the guy and I was like, yeah, there was no way. If I would have, you want to go out with me? I already have a boyfriend. Sorry. Did you watch Assassination of Jesse James? Nope. I don't give a shit about Jesse James. I don't care about cowboys or whatever, criminals. Focus meds. I think, Heather Green, you were on meds. See, this is how I know that you're a free spirit, because the meds are going to go, you're going to be free. The meds you'll stop consuming the meds. Your brain will be as high as Aladdin's flying carpet, and you are going to be in a Middle Eastern restaurant somewhere in some city, possibly Raleigh, maybe California, maybe Austin, Texas, and you're going to be smoking that hookah and you're going to be like on the flying carpet. I'm telling you, free spirit. I'm telling you, I can tell these things. I was born at night, but I wasn't born last night. I tell you guys, got a bunch of freaking songs for me to play. Oh, Lord, here we go. Amanda is the one that got away. She got away, I guess. I don't know. Hard cut to today, and your old pal Mandy is a lesbian. There was this one girl, her name was Stephanie. I was like, she was so beautiful, this woman. It was ridiculous. It was in high school. She was so good looking, this woman. I don't want to start getting into details, but I'll just say it like this. Her body was armed with all the proper ballistics. Okay, we'll just put it that way. All the ballistic missiles, she had them. And I never asked her out. We talked a couple times. That was that. We sat next to each other in chemistry class. And when I got out of high school, I remember I went to a pool, a public pool, and I was swimming around, and she was there with her, like, little brother or something. And I was like, hey, we went to school. And she's like, yeah, I remember you. We talked for like an hour. So in my brain, I'm like, dude, she's talking with you. You know, again, I was right out of high school. So the love potion is still swimming around through my blood. And I was like, oh my God, this is it, right? Like, she's the one, right? Like, we're meeting this pool. What are the chances of that? You know, like, this is a sign from heaven that this is the one. God is uniting us together. You know, you have all these thoughts. So I said, hey, do you want to have lunch sometime or dinner? And then she's like, yeah, sure. So she gives me her number. And I'm like, I am literally on the top of the world. Okay. I am like on top of the Tower of Babel. I'm on Aladdin's flying carpet. We're flying to Agrabah. The next day I gave her a call. I didn't have any text messaging. I didn't have a smartphone. I just had like one of those little Nokia iPhones. This was back in 2000 and what was this? 2008 or something. I called this woman. She's not there. I leave a voice message. This woman doesn't call me back at all. My heart was so broken. It was ridiculous. I was like so distraught. And my dad was so frustrated with me because I was always next to the phone. I'm like, is this damn phone going to ring? And then the phone would ring. I'd be like, oh, is that her? And it's like, you know, Billy Bob who wants to talk to my dad or whatever. And it's like, oh, fuck. And my dad looked at me and he said, Ted, where's that girl's number? And I gave him her number. My dad's like, throw it in the freaking trash. Enough. Enough. And I was like, fuck. So years later, I was like, whatever happened to good old Stephanie? And I looked her up and she completely blimped out and she got knocked up by some Mexican guy. So I mean, she blimped out. She looks like a giant Goodwill blimp. I feel awful saying that, but that's how I feel. She looks like a good She looked like a fucking Goodwill blimp that you see in those NFL stadiums. And I don't even watch football. See, I can look back and laugh at these things because it's all bullshit. Because you meet people who, oh, I married my high school sweetheart, divorced, miserable. And that's when you realize that none of that shit really fulfills you at the end of the day. Like, it can fulfill you if everything is sort of in harmony. It can be a part of your life's fulfillment. But for the most part, people are miserable. Like, a lot of married people are miserable. And I've been married for 4 years. 4 years. Okay, you're basically, like, still newlyweds. So many miserable people married. And the thing is, even if you had, like, access to all the women that you wanted, would you still be happy? Oh, I would. I'd be so happy, right? Like, I rarely ever get a girl, or I'm still single and blah, blah, blah. So I'd be so happy. Anthony Bourdain. I know Heather Green's going to respond to this. I know she's going to respond to this, but Anthony Bourdain was super rich, had access to women that most men will never have. Super famous, but was extremely depressed. And he eventually killed himself. And they interviewed his brother after they found his body. And his brother said, oh, my brother killed himself. This is like, you know, I'll put it to you this way. A white guy, usually, white people usually don't talk this way. But Anthony Bourdain is of a different culture. But his brother was like, oh, my brother killed himself. I mean, we all kind of expected it to happen. Why would he say that? Because Anthony Bourdain was depressed. And it wasn't that surprising when he killed himself. He talked about it several times on his interviews. He would say it, like, sometimes I feel like just killing myself. I know Heather Green disagrees. Hopefully by me saying that, she's not going to say what I know she wants to say. But he killed himself. So, and then you meet people who work at Walmart and they don't get shit and they're not killing themselves. So does it really bring you happiness?